secrets lie in the border fires and the humming wires. Yeah, man, you know you're never coming back.
My name is Anthony Byrne, and I directed season 5 of Peaky that's on right now. And I'm going to host the Q&A. So very quickly, let's get everybody on because we don't have a lot of time. So I want to introduce the writer-creator, Mr. Stephen Knight, to the stage. Major Campbell is here. Sam Neill. Our wonderful exec producer, Karen Mandebach, who runs the behind the scenes and makes it happen. Emmett Scanlon, Billy Gray from this season, come up. Michael Gray, Finn Cole, come up. Oswald Mosley,
boo.
Sam Claflin, come on up. The very beautiful Kate Phillips, come on up. Danny Whiz Bang, Samuel Edward Cook, come on up from season 1. Harry Curtin, the youngest Shelby, come on up. And last but not least, Paul Anderson, Arthur Shelby. We're 6 years from the TX of the first season, and we're almost 30 hours into Steve Knight's telling of this.
And so we used to go out chewing, and there was a, just like over that bridge there, there was a scrapyard that was owned by somebody called Charlie.
Family stories are at the heart of all good sagas, and because I too am the daughter of a gangster turned bookmaker from Chicago, and not the good bit, it is easy for me to tell stories about families, first of all, because we all have them. And then also damaged men. I know quite a few myself. So,
things that are the complete antithesis to Major Campbell. How was it coming into a show that was now very clearly established, where you have to find your place and make yourself known as a villain?
It was pretty nerve-wracking, I think, because I was a fan of the series. I just really wanted to hear people boo me. I think having the opportunity to portray someone that personally I knew nothing about, but someone that I knew when I did start learning about him, someone that was so far away from who I am as a person. I am a nice guy, I swear. I believe with everything he says, obviously. I think because it was so far removed from me, it was such a challenge. I think, and to be able to kind of enter into a world that I was such a fan of, I mean, it was a no-brainer, really. And I think I've been very, very lucky to be able to join something that has not only a great cast and a great you know, storyline, but great characters, great writing, great story arcs, and I felt very, very lucky. I felt very, very lucky, and I felt I was welcomed with open arms, and yeah, I'm very happy to be here, and thank you all for coming.
Yeah.
And our final Samuel, you were a pretty integral, you were expressing outwardly what everybody was dealing with and going through with PTSD, which is still a big theme that runs through the season. How was it coming in and playing a character like Danny Whiz Bang?
Poor guy.
Hi, everyone. I was fresh out of drama school, so I was young, you know, young actor, you know, handed this script, and I was blown away. You know, you know, if you get sent an audition through and the characters, you know, the name is, you know, Danny Whizbang, I mean, you're sort of sold already. But then obviously, you know, you sort of dig deeper and you discover why he's been given the name Danny Whizbang. And obviously sort of the context behind it, you know. You know, I did a lot of research and, you know, sort of you want to make sure your interpretation of the illness is accurate. And, you know, I was very fortunate to be given that opportunity. And it was great that, you know, sort of Tommy and Danny had those scenes where you saw that. You sort of understood why Tommy was, you know, sort of this sociopath, you know, in a way. You know, you understood why, you know, how he was affected from what they'd seen in France. But yeah, it was fantastic for me.
You were spreading it!
Thanks, mate.
There you go.
But yeah,
it was an extraordinary performance. I'm really memorable.
Thank you. No, it was great. You know, Danny was sort of, you know, blink and you miss Danny, but he was... you know, I was very fortunate. Stephen wrote some brilliant scenes, you know, that thankfully caught people's imagination. So it was, yeah, it was great to be involved with.
Finn Cole, a simple question. We've discussed it many times while we were making this season. Are you good or bad?
I am standing up. No different. Only about 4'5", leave it out. Can you see me now? Go on, what?
Is Michael Gray good or bad?
What's that?
Is Michael Gray good or bad?
Is Michael Gray good or bad?
And how did you decide to play it in the end?
I think he's good. I've got to think he's good. I think Michael's, Michael's the next generation. Maybe the future. Let's see. Or not.
Wow. It's quite divisive. Emmett, you're new to the show this season.
Thank you.
We've worked before, and we're good friends. You've yes. played very intimidating characters before. What was it like playing a role where you have to be vulnerable and fearful of others?
I guess I play a lot of bad guys, sociopaths, psychopaths. I've got a kind of a dickhead face. It's the same as my dad. It's in our genes. So to play somebody, to come in straight away and play somebody who's terrified of the Peaky Blinders, specifically Arthur, it's great. I mean, this is what you want to do. You want to stretch yourself. You know, it took me months to learn the Dublin accent to get that down. So I'm just delighted to be part of this family, this show that I've been a fan of since the very beginning. It's one of the greatest shows ever on TV. I'm so grateful for everybody who said yes, particularly you, for your incredibly low standards in casting me. So apparently I was on a list of one, and I auditioned for this, but I did it in a Brummie accent. And I got it with the Brummie accent, and then I remember I rang him up and said, mate, it's just taken me 5 weeks just to get these lines down. You can't change the lines. I only know the words. If we're riffing, I'm fucked. Right? So please do not. And then he goes, and then he just goes, okay, well, they'll probably change, number one, but let me talk to Stephen. I said, because there's never been a Dubliner in the show, has there? He goes, let me talk to Stephen. And he rang me back and said, yeah, Dublin it is. And I was like, which I definitely needed that since I was sharing my scenes with Paul.
Yeah, works thanks. Between you both that makes Linda and Arthur the creative force that they are on screen.
What's great about playing Linda of the seasons is that she's so changeable. And over the 3 years, the 3 seasons, she's sort of started off from some one place, and where she's landed up this year is completely different. So just kind of mapping her journey has been really exciting, and you're kind of never quite sure where it's going to end up. So thanks, Steve. But so much of that is playing with Paul, kind of in the room together, you know, you're an inspiration to work with. He kind of draws a lot of who Linda is out for me, and it's kind of amazing to work with you. I think part of what's so exciting is what we get to do together. And
and what an ending of episode 4. Let's see what happens. Harry, you are the youngest Shelby brother, and you've spent a long time waiting in the wings, and this season you've really kind of been, I don't know if you've earned it yet, but you've certainly been given a seat at the table. What's it like in this season, having quite the arc that you have now, and having spent so many years watching a pretty phenomenal cast?
Well, stand up, Finn. Speak up. Get up. Oh, go to the side.
Not anymore. I sit where I lie.
That's what it's like on set.
I would say, you know, I started doing this as I did my GCSEs, really. So, like, starting on this, I restarted my professional career as I was just learning what acting was. And I think each year has just been new for me, you know, watching this cast without having to, like, you know, give them even more praise. But they are phenomenal, you know. I didn't really know what the world of acting was. But then through the years, I've really appreciated it and sort of greatened my love for what I, you know, when you're young and these kind of things happen, you kind of don't know what the world's like. But it's been nice, like, they've been lovely to me. I say lovely, you just saw what Paul's like. So that's no jokes. No, just the different dynamics is great. Like, I need that kind of stuff because, you know, you're scared to push yourself. And this has been my only sort of playground, but it's just changed every year I've come back. And new directors, even more new great members to work with. So the whole time I'm trying to do my thing, I'm also absorbing and learning. And yeah, it's just like, genuinely, it's just like an honor. A lot of people my age don't really get to sort of, you know, get in the ring with all these legitimate, seasoned, tried and true actors. And yeah, it's just, yeah, it's been great. Thanks everybody. I'm excited.
Finally, Paul, you've been Arthur Shelby, who's a character who is incredibly divisive, who does things that appall everybody, and then you have this wonderful vulnerability that makes us all forgive you for your actions. And I wondered how much of Arthur, where's the line between Paul Anderson and Arthur Shelby? Sometimes I don't know. But you've really made that character your own, and it's quite a creation, and I'd love you to talk to everybody a little bit about that.
This fucking place is under new management. Listen, if Sam Neill can walk, I'll fucking walk. But I don't know where the line is drawn between me and Arthur. You can probably hear me flirt from Paul Anderson to Arthur fucking Shelby. I really do love playing the character, and I love the city of Birmingham. Is honestly, small Eve, fucking Rifles. I just wish my brother Tommy was here, or Killian was here, but or Joe, John Boy. But the line, yeah, right now, I don't know who I am, but fuck it. Don't ask me no intellectual questions and fucking ask me to explain the different fucking elements of Peaky Blinders. All I know is Stephen Knight has created something that's changed my life, and and I'm certainly grateful to him, and I'm indebted to him for many reasons, for the show, for you know, the character, and for this place. So I'm just gonna have another fucking walk up this way, you know what I mean? Fucking sound out a few people.
He bloody loves it, then ain't looking at it.
Fucking right. All right, darling. All right, yeah, all right. I only want to speak to the ladies. Fuck, no, wait. There's Linda. Hold on. I want to tell Linda what I'm doing up here. Well, that's it. So thank you all. Thanks for coming, man.
He's filming, he would have been here, he's done some recordings of stuff that you'll be hearing during the day, but from the, you know, the whole of us, all of us, I hope you have a fantastic day by order of the Peaky fucking Blinders.
Anyone else have anything to say?
Thank you, Anthony. You're the best.
One more thing just before we go. It's Sam Neill's birthday today.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you,
Sam.
Happy birthday, dear Sam. Happy birthday to you.
See, it's not all that bad, right? Thank you very much. We'll see you later.
You're fucked.
On a gathering storm comes a tall, handsome man in a dusty black coat with a red right hand.
this fucking tin pot. Start again. That's how well the fucking works. This one's called Morning Clock.
What's this?
See you later, happy snaps. Hi, this one's called Shockwave.
Single thing that